It's always important to keep in mind, I think we've mentioned this a number of times, that modernism, of course, touches much more than simply painting and sculpture. There's also architecture, which unfortunately we haven't been able to talk enough about, although we've had a few examples. But it also had a great impact on literature. So I'm very pleased that my colleague, George Grabowicz, the Dmytro Czyżewski Professor of Ukrainian Literature and the former director of our institute, was able to be here also as a participant. He's done a number of works on Ukrainian literature, and including modernism. In fact, one of his projects currently is precisely that. And he's going to talk about modernism in Ukrainian poetry, the paradigm of Pavlo Tychyna.
Well, thank you very much. We're beginning 20 or so minutes late. I
no,
hope
no,
we'll
we're
have
going
that
to,
time.
We're going to give
yes,
you time.
That's
course,
good.
That means yes.
Yes, I'm aware of the strictures here. It's a pleasure to address you. As I've said in my handout, or rather in the paper that you got, albeit late, this has been a long-standing project of mine. I've been working on Tychyna for the last 30 years or more. And what you have in this draft is really the draft not so much of a paper as of a monograph. Obviously, we don't have time to read a whole monograph today, and what I would like to do is to focus primarily on some texts and to just give a general picture of what is the major and perhaps the most tragic Ukrainian writer of the 20th century. A writer who, as those of you who have skimmed this will know, and those of you who are in any way attuned to Ukrainian literature and Ukrainian culture, know that he still is recognized as the major 20th century Ukrainian writer. And at the same time, a writer who seems to be, at least in the popular esteem, to be despised, almost hated. There are ditties that go around to the effect of a Tychyna pisze wierszy, ta wse hirszy, ta wse hirszy.
They're worse and worse.
This is amazing. It is a kind of a tragic fate, which is analogous to the kind of historical fate that met Ukrainian modernism and maybe Ukrainian culture in the 20th century. Because on the one hand, we have, and the issue that I'm dealing with is not only the fate of a writer, but the fate of his reception, that is to say, his standing, his canon, his role in our memory, in our awareness. On the one hand, we have a 12-volume edition of Tychyna, which was not complete, which was begun in the Brezhnev years in 83 and finished in 1990, which was censored, although much of the censoring at the end was self-censoring. And at the same time, as far as I can tell, an edition where no one read beyond the third volume, because there's an awful lot of interesting material in this 12-volume edition that, to my knowledge, and I have been working on Tychyna for a while now, no one has really brought into the discourse around Tychyna. It's as if it wasn't there. And on the other hand, the actual presence of Tychyna and the reason that he became as hated, maybe is too strong a word, but resisted by the school children is because this is how he was presented. A thin little collection, virshi, which is, as it were, it's all Tychyna's, but it's all presented, as it were, for the third grade or the fourth grade. So there's actually even no consensus as what is the real Tychyna. The issue comes down, and I will just recapitulate it in a word, and I see time is running so quickly, gee, is the issue of the late and the early Tychyna, or the early and the late Tychyna. I think that it is a specious distinction, although the opposite ends are clearly immensely different. But if anyone saw the exhibit of Picasso that was held here in Boston, the early Picasso and the very late Picasso are all also extremely different. And the whole question is not only of the timing of how this happens, but what are some of the internal structures? And my contention is that the very opposition, a kind of a binary look at Tychyna, with the late obviously bad and the early, whatever that is, obviously great, is that it devalues both ends. That it is actually an anti-poetic notion. Obviously, as it was initially used, especially by nationally or indeed nationalistically inclined poets and critics like Malagnuk, it was implicitly ideological. My concern, and when I speak of paradigm, I mean that Tychyna exemplifies modernism by the very fact that he is not limited to, and he's continually experimenting with and developing his poetic craft, is not limited to symbolism, that it goes on to moments that clearly echo with futurism, but even more so in the collections Chernihiv and even Partia Vede with constructivism. The whole question of the core or the basis on which this modernism can, I think, most productively be examined is precisely various techniques or various devices which are close to or dear to the modernist stance or perspective. One of these, I think, is intertextuality. I've spoken on this a couple of years ago, but since then my thinking has become a bit more focused and certainly more, I hope, more differentiated. On the one hand, if you were to look at the handout that I gave you, one of the things that is particularly clear from the beginning, that Tychyna is very self-conscious of his craft. Each one of his early collections begins with a reflection on what kind of poetry it is that he is doing. So the lead poem of the first collection of poetry, Sonyashni Klarnety, ends, Navik ya vznau shutiny hniv, lish sonyashni klarnety. It's a meditation, if you will, a prayer to a divine entity, and then realizing that you are not ni Zeus, ni Pan, ni Holub Duch, but a new divine principle. These sonyashni klarnety. The problem with that was that it was such a powerful vision that it hypnotized his audience. And he himself wrote that my folks here in, or rather he's writing to Zero from Kharkiv to Kyiv, he's saying the people there in Kyiv expect me to be continually writing sonyashni klarnety. You know, second edition, third edition, always the same thing. By that time, in 1924, he was on to a totally different stage, having already written in 1920 both Pluch and Zamisuneti Yuktau. In 1924, it was Viter z Ukrainy, precisely that collection which for some was unacceptable. This was no longer the Tychyna that they thought that they knew. What characterizes Tychyna too is a dialogic principle, one which is in miniature presented in something like Odchinyajte Dveri, which we have here, or in this very fine poem, Desh Nadchodila Vesna, where the poem itself seems to be a dialogue with nature and at the same time with a lover. And she is both Vesna and a woman. I don't have time to read the whole thing, but this is what it is, a love affair presented as the sequencing of the seasons, spring going into summer, into fall, into winter, and then again into spring. It seems to be perfectly cyclical. Or now in the same issue, but now in the collection Pluch, the oppositions of the new order, how it will be seen. If you can take a look at it, let me just read it to you. I буде так, сліпі, де ж те небо, я не бачу, глухі, мені здається, правду б я почув, каліки, плачу, от болю кричу. І буде так, фальшиве небо сміхом хтось розколе, і стане світ новий, і люди як боги, і скрізь, де буде поле, плуги, плуги. I think that for some who were expecting a symbolist poetics, even this was beginning to jar, but things were going to become even more complex. The whole collection, and here I gave you only a few selections, of Zamisuneti Yuktau, instead of sonnets and octaves, is a collage. It's based entirely on a principle of collage, and at the same time on a sense of culture as having been reduced to a detritus of culture, as if as in Eliot's The Wasteland, remnants of culture, fragments of culture, which also resonates with the image of the poet, like in the myth of Orpheus being torn apart by the Bacchante and only the membra dissecta remain. Both ideological, if you will, and essentially poetic fragmentation. And yet within it, the resonance or the insights that emerge are perhaps even more powerful, and indeed more powerful, were it given as a fully congealed and finished version. If you take a look in the next section, the whole question of reworking. Here he has a miniature poem. One would think one can't do anything with it, and yet, still in the very early period, Tychyna is already taking this as an opportunity to do a kind of secondary elaboration. A miniature poem written, by the way, for a children's audience, but in 1917. So this is not what we'll see in the 1950s. A ja u haj chodila po kwitku ось яку, a tam дерева люлі, і все отак зозулі, ку-ку. Я зайчика зустріла, дрімав він на горбку, була б його спіймала, зозуля і злякала, ку-ку. Well, next to it, you see, is a ja u haj chodila as an inscenization. You know, how could you make that? And yet, there it is. From this miniature, there is a whole scene with a mother and a child, and actually a kind of a chorus that comes out from nowhere, because in the end, everybody says, usi, cuckoo. But things become much more interesting when we come to the so-called middle period. So-called, actually, it's not so-called, I call it that way. There is no consensus on it because the Tychyna scholarship is not polarized. It is only in one camp. I can't really repeat all the arguments because they're all here, actually. This part of the paper is pretty succinctly, I think, that is, say, pretty coherently presented. The rest is very synoptic and also an outline. But the idea that there was a good early and a bad late Tychyna is now official canon. Before, it was a bit more complex because the emigres were saying one thing and the Soviets another, but now everybody is saying one thing. But then what to do with these very interesting middle poetry of the middle period, that is to say of the late 20s, early 30s. There is a whole collection called Chernihi, which is a kind of a reportage, where the poet is concealed or hidden, or if you will, absconded. And everything that occurs is overheard. These are voices that one hears, as if he were a kind of a free-floating microphone. And the only thing that comes from the poet's voice are just the titles. As in this case, «Мій друг робітник водить мене по місту і хвалиться». And then all you hear is just the praise and the boasting and the ever louder noise of propaganda. The reason I gave you two texts in this case is because one on the right side is the one as it was finally published in 1983 edition, where there is no punctuation, where words run one into the other, and the one on the left is what was of that which was printed, because usually it was never printed in its entirety, but even that was bowdlerized and punctuated in order to make it more accessible. In other words, writing texts that are presumably entirely orthodox, entirely kosher, entirely party and ideology oriented, still intuitively felt to be very tricky and very problematic. And even more so when you look at Partia Vede, the subtitle of which is Pisni Peane Hymne. The poet is no longer there. It is only songs, only peons. And this lead poem, Partia Vede, by the way, was published in Ukrainian on the first page of Pravda in 1933. It was considered the most, if you will, powerful and persuasive example of the lead Ukrainian poet becoming one of the an official spokesman of the regime. But if you look at the poem, it is a poem issuing from the mouths of the pionere. That is to say, not even komsomolci. As he says, zbilshevichinoi ere pionere, pionere, partia vede. There is an implicit contradiction here. What is the ideological worth of a message of this sort. By the way, something that has also not really come into the canon of Tychyna criticism is a very fine piece of analysis of rhetorical and formal criticism written by none other than Yuri Shevelov, on this collection of poetry. It exists, and yet no one seems to refer to it. And if they do refer to it, always as a kind of Shevelov's own, as it were, sin of acceding to ideological pressures. On the contrary, it's an excellent piece of writing, and precisely pointing to the sophisticated rhetorical and other devices that one is obliged to, or one can infer, Tychyna is obliged to do in moments of such ideological stricturing. Okay. Speaking of that, the section on Stalin inserted and deleted, you will see what happens when there is a whole poem, Pisnya pro Stalina, which has eight stanzas, and then the poem as repeated in the 1984 edition, where there are only four stanzas. Same poem, but all the four stanzas that deal with Stalin have been deleted. The poem as it were, a flexible work, one that one can add and subtract things from it, is itself a kind of a mini collage. Tychyna, as the author of children's writing, this is from the Harvard Library. It says, "Vishyemo Stalina portret." And 1950, we don't know what the tiraj is. It probably may have been hundreds of thousands. Certainly this one had 30,000, and this was one way of addressing a very large audience. You can see how poetry that goes, how the whole thing is then recapitulated. This is somewhat long, but on page 26, you have the whole poem concisely presented without Stalin there, that is to say, without four stanzas or so. But what is interesting is if you look at the next poem, Moskva nam mate, it is also children's poetry. It is also children's poetry. The implicit addressee, although speaking about such things as the Soviet Union, Russia, Moscow, and so on, it is the implied audience is one of eight-year-olds or nine-year-olds. There is the phenomenon, I think, of the unknown Tychyna. And that is Tychyna that exists in excellent poetry, but one which simply has not come to the reader yet. And I will try to wrap up so that we can have a discussion. It is primarily in fragments. His whole large poem, Skovoroda, is unfinished and is in fragments. It's a wonderful piece of work. But I think even better are three fragments, which I myself have started calling, although the line is from Tychyna, so I think proper or if you will, justified, because he himself uses that phrase before Dovzhenko did, Ukraina vohni. It's a large epic poem in beautiful hexameter, which he began writing sometime in 1920. He published three excerpts. He published one excerpt in 1925, Chistila mate kartoplu. Two further excerpts from that cycle were never published, only much later. And then he published in 1938 the epic poem, same poem, he clearly indicates that this is part of a larger whole, called Shabla Kotovskoho. Despite the fact, especially in the latter pieces, especially in the Sword of Kotovsky, Kotovsky, by the way, a Soviet general and also a war criminal. That is to say, he butchered a whole regiment of Ukrainian soldiers from the other side who had surrendered, who were war prisoners. Whether Tychyna did this consciously or not is another question. But here is this poem about Kotovsky, which is, if you will, official, excellent, prime socialist realism, totally interlarded with modernism. This coexistence of a socialist realist content or ideological form subverted by, introjected with modernist content, also form, is a remarkable Tychynian phenomenon. Let me just illustrate one moment for you. There's not enough time to read it, although this section that I did, which begins Tam devihin odhorojeny od cerkve shtahetom, continues in terms of its imagery, exactly at the moment where Kotsubinsky's Fata Morgana ends. Fata Morgana ends with na svitanok do sela vishle kozakir, to pacify the town. The Cossack is here, but now suddenly the shift is from 1905, from the first revolution, to 1917. But the real, and this I would like to end with, well, I still need to tell you about the found poetry, but what I would like to do as far as this poem is concerned, if you would look at page 32, it's in the beginning of Shabla Kotovskoho. The characters are themselves intertextual. One of the characters is an echo of Rudy Pańko, and you know where he comes from. And suddenly they are having a discussion about politics. They're doing a prodzohon. They have just gathered some requisitions from the peasants. They're bringing them to the center, village center, and they're having a discussion about politics. This is in the middle of page 32. You see what is happening in this official socialist realist text. Kuź, anu pregadajte, jak wy, buduczy wże niezależnikami, powstawania proti radzianskiej władzy піднімали. Куцу вимислили, чорно надіялись, мріяли синю. Що в вас міцніше, чи синь, чи куцінь, я не годен сказати. Синь чи куцінь пролетіла синичка, а друга з берези, жовтої-жовтої стишино, синь чи куцінь обізвалась. Синь чи куцінь, повторила синички, і дальні над яром, а там іще й інші в червоному шумі, чути куцінь, потім жовтої шелест берези од вітру, вітру восики сипнуло куцінь, розлетілося листя, цінь, ледве чути крізь трепет, а сонце як от, як не блисне. And in this fashion, what has happened to the poem? What has happened to the addressee? Suddenly, it's as if it takes off on its own. It's a remarkable phenomenon which the critics themselves seem not to have noticed. It's still unknown. Let me conclude by pointing your attention to the fact that the Tychyna was particularly attuned to what I'm calling here, although this is probably self-evident, a kind of ready material or found poetry. He had a collection which he thought was lost during the war, but actually was found, which he began sometime in 1908, which he called Zoloto i Musur. Various things that simply came up that he then plugged back into the poetry. And the guiding, if there is a guiding principle here, it seems to be the surreal and the absurd. That which exists in the narod, but which has a peculiar double or this decentered meaning. Such moments, for example, as Святий Бозе, Святий Клепкий, а дубове денце, or Був такий піп, що на його мінини гості ходили своїми харчами, or хоч би скоріш земля крутилась. Let me stop here and entertain your questions.
All right, thank you very much. We have comments, questions, from John?
Well, it just seemed you got another example in the 20th century, but a Russian example you might not think of if this is going to be a monograph, and that's, of course, the sad fate of Mayakovsky, mm-hmm. who is often divided into precisely this way. There's the early Mayakovsky, who's the futurist, who's wonderful, and then there's the late one, who's just stepped mm-hmm. on his own voice, crushed himself, mm-hmm. committed suicide, mm-hmm. didn't live long enough to do some of the awful things Tychyna seems to have done. Mm-hmm. But it's very similar, and as a result, of course, he's even practically out of school curriculums now. And you never hear him talked about particularly. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it's terrible because, of course, he's one of 20th century Russia's greatest poets, but has experienced this fate.
Yeah, it's a very good point. It needs to be, I think, the comparative. Usually when one speaks about a great poet becoming bad, the image that the poet that one thinks of is Wordsworth. You know, here is this wonderful romantic poet who suddenly becomes poet laureate and is carried out, as one critic said, like a pygmy on the shield of his reputation. The other phenomenon is of a poet in a mediocre mode becoming a great poet in his old mode, and that is William Butler Yeats. But of a great poet sort of willfully becoming, what Tychyna seems to have become is rather striking, yes. Although my argument is not to deny that the late poetry, especially of the 50s and to his death in 1967, has become extremely flat and implicitly children's poetry, but that the period of his transformations is extremely drawn out and in the middle period extremely interesting. And if one looks especially at the fragments, one can construct a large and very impressive corpus of Tychyna situated precisely between 1918, Sonyashny Klernety, and about 1940, certainly 1938, which would include in the later period such works as this epic poem, Shabla Kotowsko, or Ukraina Vohnie, as he himself seems to want to call it, and Skovoroda.
George, okay. just one more. Was he familiar at all with Klebnikov?
Yes.
Because when you were reading that passage,
yes.
It started to sound like yes. Zangezi to me.
Yes.
Ukrainsky Korb.
Yes. Clearly, and this the element of a Zaum-like moment is very apparent also in Chernihiv.
Uh-huh.
In Chernihiv, yes.
Interesting.
Any questions from this side of the room? Moving across, comments. Zirko?
Analogies, perhaps, the sort of Tychyna's change of styles, which sort of upset his followers, reminds me very much of Stravinsky. Because after Stravinsky wrote his three big ballets, which should be equivalent to the early poetry, he changed his style and got people rather upset. And then he proceeded to change his style again.
Mm-hmm.
And perhaps for different reasons, but nevertheless, it was that kind of a change of style seems to be fairly common in 20th century artists anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the other thing that I wanted to ask you was your reaction to the idea that perhaps, in a way, socialist realism has had an undue bad rap, that perhaps just like in music, which has recently been discovered that there is quite a bit of it that is quite good,
mm-hmm.
and some of it has even hidden messages in the same way perhaps that the Tychyna's has. We can think of Shostakovich's Fifth Symphony, which is sort of a prime example of a great social realist work that in the end has a series of what might what call hidden messages to such an extent that when Bernstein came with the New York Philharmonic to Moscow and did the performance of the Fifth Symphony with a heroic ending, everybody thought it was absolutely wrong, because it's not that.
Mm-hmm.
So I was wondering whether you felt that perhaps there are works during this period that have a hidden message that we simply right now have not been able to penetrate yet.
Yeah. Well, let me say this. The analogy is hard to draw because music is not semantic. It's music. Obviously, that is said from the layman's point of view. You might argue that it's not really the case, but still, he is not, in semantically objective terms, obliged to express a certain ideology. It might be lowered to be more accessible to a certain audience. It might have such or other, I don't know, I'm really spinning my wheels on this one. But in the literary thing, I'm hard-pressed to exonerate socialist realism, especially if one defines it as literature written with the censor in mind, literature written with the consequences in mind. That is to say, literature that is implicitly straitened and implicitly threatened. And there is nothing redeeming to be said for that. At the same time, having said that, there is the Tychyna case. He is writing in 1938, this is after the terror of the purges. He is writing a line like, "A Lenin nam rude telatko podarit," you know. But the syllogism is "Lenin rude telatko." You know, this is very dangerous stuff. You know, he is as if playing dancing on the edge. Similarly with some of these. I mean, he was always on the verge of being accused of formalism, and indeed is inserting formalism into texts that purport to be socialist realist. I don't think this is real socialist realism. His later work is, to be sure. You can't do this kind of deconstruction with things written in the 1950s. Although, still, to go back to what I said earlier, the play with voice, the kind of implicit ventriloquism, where it's not him who is saying it, this is what he's hearing. This "всіх панів до одної ями буржую за буржуями будем бить." This is very true stuff. This is right at the famine. This is the only text that we know that speaks about the famine, during the famine. "Всіх панів до одної ями." You know, it's hair-raising stuff. Tychyna was depicted by many of his critics, both the well-meaning and the angry ones, as being a naïf, a person who didn't really know what he was doing. I think when one reads this stuff, one sees that he knew it very well, and therefore some of this boldness in the later poetry is very, very striking.
Yes, Makarik.
Is again maybe the adjective performative the one that we're looking for with Tychyna? The mm-hmm. masks, the roles, mm-hmm. the voices, mm-hmm. The play mm-hmm. of where is the real Tychyna?
Mm-hmm. He has a poem in this "За всіх скажу, за всіх переболію," you know, where he. Let me just cite it because nothing works so well as some of the texts themselves. Where he, this itself is maybe a double bottom, but he says, "За всіх." This is from "Вітер з України" in 1924. So he's this is well before purges and terror. Although the sense that things are coming, the good poets knew, and he wrote his "Хіба собі поцілувати пантофлю папи" at the end of "Замісонети Октау" in 1920. I mean, the having to bow to the new pope was still a long ways off. Anyway, за всіх скажу, за всіх переболію, я кожен час на звіт іду, на суд. Глибина мене ще встану, глибина мене встану, не змілію, верхівлями розкрилено росту. And then the next stanza. Всього мене, а вже сучасний дій всього мене обняв, здавив, напружив, і я встаю, нову вдихаю міць. Не мрію, ні, повіки я розмружив. Іронія і гордість на лиці, іронія. Well, I don't know. I think that he's saying that, but this ability to control things with irony is not necessarily what one usually associates with him. But performative, yes, I certainly would agree with that. The projecting of voices, the tendency towards drama, this hexameter epic poem is very dramatic. There are continually voices breaking in and out of it. It's a very decentering kind of poetry. And remarkably, maybe because of this difficulty, not really studied. One is hard-pressed to speak of, especially of the post-Sonyashni Klarnete period, to speak of good studies of Tychyna.
Okay. Yes, Vladimir Dibrova. Mm.
Yeah. I think you're having your fingers on something really, really important, like Tychyna, because Tychyna is really the pivotal character in Ukrainian literature, and probably I think that he could be compared with Bob Dylan in terms that he evolved, you know, from album to album. From we can talk about totally different artists, and there are so many important issues that you raised that let me just concentrate on a couple of them. Why is Tychyna unknown? And I think it takes like a generation or two before he's really will begin to understand what he was really about. Let me give you one example. Way back in 94, I was discussing Chernihiv with a group of Ukrainian literary and literary critics, and I was trying to say how complex that thing is and how important, and I was trying to draw parallels between this and the wasteland. Not in terms like they're doing right now. So we were the first, and so on and so forth. I'm not too interested in that, mm-hmm. because obviously Tychyna didn't know anything about T.S. Eliot, but the similarity was striking.
Yes.
In fact, there was only one thing that they were interested in, was that was he sincere or was he not sincere?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, mm-hmm. and so. Probably Tychyna epitomizes so many, you know, good and bad things. Matter of fact, the best and the worst in Ukrainian history, in Ukrainian psyche, that we are afraid to look into it and to study it. So we need distance
mm-hmm.
just to understand what it's all about.
Mm-hmm.
And right now, there's the kind of revisionist wave saying that, no, when he was saying Partia Vede, he really meant this and that. You know what, that reminds me of Keith Richard, who a couple of days ago admitted that he snorted coke with his father's ashes, and then in New York Times a couple of days after that there was a British anthropologist who was claiming no, he was just following the ritual of Papua New Guinea, he was just experimenting in the way of the 60s, he just carried on being with it, that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's also tells us something about where we are at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
But any analysis of the previous epoch, and I understand that it's very painful. Number one thing, nobody is studying socialist realism. Why? Because socialist realism is the continuation of modernism. Just like fascism, was brought up by futurism. And that's a very painful discovery. And it's if you read Fanon, mm-hmm. you know what we are talking about. Mm-hmm. So, but I'm looking forward to reading your book.
Thank you very much. I just would like to add one more thing. Tychyna was too subtle, too sophisticated not to know the parodic content of what he was doing. It could not but be, especially since we have records of his letters. By the way, his epistolary output is very small. It is mainly to friends. But even the few that remain, especially his brief correspondence with Zerov, showed that he was very much attuned to what both the critics were saying, to what was there to be read on deeper levels. And the fact that writing the Partia Vede poems and not expecting that this will be immediately juxtaposed, contrasted with what was made earlier, it stands to reason. So
the ironies and subtleties are totally lost on his contemporary reading.
Yes, clearly. And he also foresaw, and this to me is extremely poignant, that the Orphic myth, the myth of Orpheus, is precisely of the poet descending into Hades, going back into hell, trying to get Eurydice out. He could not have been impervious to that.
Other comments, questions?
I think everybody's tired by now.
Okay, very good. Well, thank you again.